Tonight is our workshop meeting, and as you know, in our workshop, we don't actually vote, we just discuss. And so, to have the room set up, which gives us a little bit more opportunity to have some face-to-face conversation, not only with each other, but with you, we thought might be a little bit, make the meeting a little bit easier to follow and encourage discussion and dialogue. So, if you'd like to grab an agenda, we have agendas over here on the podium. You can follow along on that. The first item on our agenda this evening is a public hearing for a request to rezone 4.39 acres located at North Murray Avenue. And Rob, I'll turn that over to you to begin that public
hearing.
Thank
you, Mayor. I'd like to open this public meeting on application number PP18-0040. I'd like everybody to know that the City of Tiffin has written public hearing procedures, the standard for exercising zoning powers, and the authority conflicts of laws are available to hand out and posted to the public review. The matter under consideration tonight is an application by Jason Hendricks is to reclassify approximately 4.39 acres of land located Murray Avenue North from its current classification of suburban agricultural to R14 single family residential. At this time, I'd like to ask the council the conflict questions. Have any of these applicants or opponents to the application contributed at least $250 to any of the campaign for election in the last the past 2 years?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a property interest that would be affected by the proposed rezoning reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or a negative impact?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a financial interest in any business entity that has a property interest in any real property that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
All right, this time I'd like to ask Ms. Annie Long to come up and talk a little bit about the rezoning application as well as the planning and zoning recommendation staff presentation.
Madam Mayor, distinguished members of the council, the aforementioned application for the rezone was submitted to Planning and Zoning, and Planning and Zoning reviewed it, and after discussion, approved it unanimously. Staff recommends that we also approve the rezoning. Are there any questions?
Pictures, please.
Oh yeah, we do have some pictures that we can show you, Stephen. Jonathan. We just show you right where it's at. That is the southeast corner of the property. That is right there where that white sign is. That's where it's posted at, that driveway there, and it extends all the way to the back. You can't see the end of the road. It is in the picture, but there will be 12 lots there, single family dwellings. Go to the next picture.
Next.
Shows that's from the corner. It's a considerable way back there. Go to the next one, and you can see the overview. You'll have to forgive my red lines. That's done with a mouse. So, but that is the proposed area.
Next.
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 I don't know, all that was in our packet, submitted in our packet with the layout.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
All right, at this time I'll take any comments from the public. Is there anyone here that would like to speak in favor of the application? Is there anyone here who'd like to speak in opposition to the application? Mayor, I see no public comment. I ask this public hearing to close.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Danny.
Thank you.
All right, the next item on our agenda is something I'm very excited about. It involves two very special ladies, Miss Mary Glenn Hendricks and Miss Sid Blackmore, about our citizens' art collection. Some time back, we had, when we moved back into the Mayan Hotel, when City Hall moved back in, we have a fabulous citizens art collection that actually belongs to this community. And it, while it was a great art collection and had been collected over many, many years by the city, usually during the Love Affair Fine Arts Festival, we didn't really have something, an updated piece of material that we could put in people's hands so that they could learn about the art, learn about the artist, the medium, maybe what the subject matter was, and so these two ladies have worked diligently to put something together for us. So Sid and Mary Glenn, I'll invite you to come up if you'd like to and show us what you've put together.
Did you all
That was in our packet, okay, but I'd like, yeah. It was just a scanned copy, so.
Well, let me hand you.
Yes.
Several years ago, and to do it in a hopefully in an effective and creative way, so that it could be available to the public. And after getting it installed, we did create a brochure that can be picked up by the public as they come in on the main floor. And hopefully, I understand that the Gazette is interested in doing an article on this to make it. To be sure that the public knows that this is here and that it's available and encourage people to come. Sid was actually involved with it from the very beginning with the Arts Experiment Station and can share a little bit more with you about the value, and it is an incredible exhibit and value, and how it a little bit more about how it came to be. But it's been a pleasure to work on this and to get the City Hall and the Mayan appropriately decorated.
Well, I just add a little history to what she said, and also to thank Pete and Mary Glenn for her work in reinstalling it, because now it really does show off. But many of you probably don't know that the whole idea for the collection came from a city councilman actually before the Fine Arts Festival started, and that was Bob Ragsdale, who came up with the idea of having an art collection that belonged to the citizens of the community and housing it here at City Hall. So it's gone through a lot of reiterations over its lifetime, and I think it looks its best the way Mary Glenn has put it back together. So I hope people will come and appreciate it. We're unlike any other small city I know, we have this art collection, and it's something for us to be proud of. It's something distinctive and something that visitors will really appreciate seeing, that Tifton supports its cultural life. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Sid. That is wonderful. And we do just want to remind you, this is this building is, it doesn't involve the name on the title of the property, City of Tifton. It's your building. It is your City Hall. And to have this art collection that's available for anyone to come in and view, just grab the brochure, wander through all three floors, and take your time. It's really, the building itself is an incredible building, but to have this art collection housed in this historic property, I think is something, Sid, that's very unique for our community. And it does emphasize the fact that we appreciate and respect and acknowledge the cultural contributions of these artists to our community, and we're very thankful for the two of you for what your work on this, and I think it's a great thing.
Yeah, Mayor and Council, I want to also thank both of you for just a tedious couple months. Sid called and said, what are you doing with all the pictures? Why are you throwing them away? And that's how this whole started. We were trying to paint and do some improvement. But with their help, and really Mary Glenn categorized the pictures, so we started classifying and putting them up, and they just laid it out in a very unique way. And the great thing about the brochure, so someone can pick this up, we have now little handouts that we could keep in various spots. So if someone wanted to follow the collection, they have set it up where you go to number one, and actually there's a description of what the actual art is, and so you could follow that. They're all numbered, very, very well done, and I think it's a great effort now that it's completed with some help, but there were some long afternoons that you put in painting and caulking and, you know, reframing. So there's a lot of work, and I wanted to personally thank both of you for hanging in there with me, and the final product is just awesome for City Hall. So I'm glad to present that.
I have to add one last thing.
Yes.
A collection doesn't stop.
Right.
So if there's ever funds once a year, if you're interested in adding it, you've got lots of room upstairs.
That's a very good point. Yes, we need to talk about that. Absolutely. I agree. That's a great point. Thank you, and we will. So we will work on that. And we'll be calling on your expertise to help us with that. So thank you very much.
We are happy to do that.
We have lots of walls, as you can see, upstairs too. Okay. Any other comments on our art collection? Nothing good? Okay. The next item under old business is review of the zoning comparisons. I know that we had talked about this in several of our last meetings. Danny, do you want to present that information to us on the information that was needed by the council?
If you remember, Mayor and Council, this came about when we were talking with the general business, which you bring off the table tonight, but in the Harvey's area from the commercial business. And I think some of you just wanted to see side by side what was allowed in GB general business and what was allowed in neighborhood commercial. And Danny, if you could just walk through those specifically, just for your information, so you could see it. If you have any questions, we'd be glad to answer that.
Yeah, so did y'all all receive that in your packet?
We
okay,
did.
So I just took everything. There are some additional design standards for specific things, but they weren't really applicable to this. But the main thing is the comprehensive plan, the map. I tried to include a copy of that, and I gave y'all what the, let's see if I can get it here.
Just go right down the list, Amy, and just we'll go right through all these questions, and we'll sure ask questions. We'll go right down the list and lining up, like, you know, just start on the zoning, like animal kettles and agriculture, and we could walk through side by side.
Yeah, so it's you see no residential in GB, and no personal care, no institutional type in general business, but they are allowed in neighborhood commercial, and residential professional will allow homes, but not the institutional. The rest of it deals with businesses, and you can see the list is quite lengthy.
I've got a crazy question.
Absolutely.
What? Okay. Does the P mean permitted or prohibited?
It means permissible, with
permissible.
No other
okay.
requirements.
And then what about the S?
The S means it's permitted, but there are supplemental requirements for them to be able to do it in that zone.
Okay. And then, like, for example, under neighborhood commercial single family dwellings, there's an S. What's the F for? Is that for the design standards?
That is for the additional design
okay.
standards.
Okay. I just want to make sure I'm following this correctly. Okay.
And I can tell you that has to do with the allowable concrete that's on the property
okay.
for that particular use.
Okay.
So this is just used to design our neighborhoods and how we want our neighborhoods to grow and how we want our city to flourish. And
well, you know, I was one that raised all the troubles within my district, but and I've gone through the list, and there's a reason why it's neighborhood commercial and not general business, because there's some things in general business that I wouldn't want in a neighborhood. And neighborhood commercial is by the definition neighborhood, and yeah, there's a Harvey's and you can have grocery stores in there, but across the street are houses, are neighborhoods. You've got, you know, next to Harvey's, you say, well, Harvey's just signed a 30-year lease or 20-year, whatever they did. Well, next to them, there's five or six individual spot businesses, which some of them are vacant. I really don't want a bar in there. I mean, that, you know, and you can't in a neighborhood commercial, but you can in general business. So this list just confirms what I'd rather keep neighborhood commercial than neighborhood commercial. If something came up, some particular business, because we're not sitting here dealing with a business that wants to come in and
that's
they're
correct.
Asking, can you change it? Then we would readdress it and see, is there a reason to? But I see no need to open ourselves up and have this neighborhood, like I said before, I got more flack over the hospital and building that building back there, and there was nothing we could do about it, and the neighbors across the street were there were furious, and they're still furious, and they'll continue to be furious, but there
absolutely.
Was nothing we could do about it. Now, the hospital has made it look really good. I mean, I go by there almost every day. It looks great, so they've done that. But if I live across the street from it, I'm not sure I would think it looks great. So I just see no reason to make this change just for the sake of, well, let's just make the change.
That's a fair assessment. And when it comes to the zoning, it really gets cumbersome sometimes. So if you're satisfied with lining those up, just making sure that if you're informed, I really see any harm, no foul, especially with the Harvey's if something does come up, which we'll try to remain consistent with the comp plan and improve that, but I just don't see it being an issue either. So.
All right, any other comments, questions, suggestions before we move on? Okay. All right, so that basically then covers items 3, 4, and 5 on our agenda. So now we are at item number 6, review of the Commerce Way parking lot. That was previously tabled. Do you want to handle that, or is it Annie?
Okay, I will. I'll take care of that. I'll bring this back around. This is for the facade wall and the redevelopment fund grant. If you remember last meeting, I talked through about numbers and presented also to the DDA. I have to apologize. We included something that probably shouldn't have been in the budget. So we had some figures that we need to correct. Jessica and I really scrubbed this very, very hard. And I'm very confident now that looking at the grant budget compared to the proposed changes, there's about a $63,000 estimated increase if the DDA so chooses to keep the facade. So you could see on the second page, the allocation, the grant funding is $376,000. The city's cost is $113,732. DDA was committed $70,000. So what happens now, if you want to, again, put this back to the DDA, and if they want to save the wall, you have, the choice to say, well, we'll split it with you, or DDA, if you want to save the wall, then you have to fund that from your pot of money. So it's really however you'd like to do it. But the numbers, I'm very, very solid with, comfortable with that.
Has the DDA received this updated information?
They have not received this yet.
So the entrance to this parking area is coming off the back alley?
No, on the front side of Commerce Way.
So Commerce would be the entry point?
Yeah.
Didn't they show a picture of where the facade was going to be?
Yeah, if he's...
And then there would be parking.
I think it's beside it, right? And the entrance way.
Yeah, on the front page, Wes, if you go to the...
There's, on page 60, there's...
All
it
right.
Should have the 60 in your packet.
Page.
It's just showing the facade thing.
Right. So is this the Commerce Way right here?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's so this is Commerce Way. Where's a car going to go?
No, there's another building. Turn to go to this page right here, page 60, and you'll see an area here that says reinforced area. That would be the facade. That's the picture that you're looking at.
Okay.
But next door to that is an open area that would be the entrance and exit.
It's parking behind the wall.
Yeah, because that building next to it is going to be gone.
The wall doesn't cover the whole front. It just,
okay.
Where that Davis Music building is.
But there'll be an exit off of that back alley?
It's not showing here as an exit off the back alley. On this proposal.
This is a paved alley.
Right.
On the back, and it looks like you would
come
through.
How
would, if you circled at the top right here, you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Would you drive on the alley? Well, I guess what I'm saying is I've heard that people who own businesses on Commerce or on the other, is that, I guess, Main Street on the other side?
Mm-hmm.
They're really proud of the ownership of that alley, and they don't want to, sometimes they won't move to get people through that alleyway. So I didn't know if it's going to be a problem. Because don't a lot of business owners on Main Street, don't they, they're asked to park behind their buildings now? Is that correct?
Well, some of
whenever
the buildings,
possible, yeah.
Yeah, some of the buildings do have parking that's part of their property that's behind their building. Their building doesn't come all the way back to the alley.
Mm-hmm.
So they've got a recess that they could park. For example, behind Colonial Inn, which is next door to the Tiff Theater facing Main, they've got a pretty deep recess. They've got a lot of parking. They've actually got an upper level and a lower level before they get onto the public parking area. So,
does the property line, does it go to the middle of that alley, or is that alley the city's?
The alley be the city's.
The alley is the city's, okay. You might want to look into that, just because I know that there's been some, two business owners I know have already kind of had some words with one another about blocking the alleyway, so to speak, so just one.
I don't know. We have two DEA members. We have Jared Ross, and of course, Frank is our council representative. I don't know, Jared, if you have any comment or input you want to share with us, or?
Well, the plan for the parking layout, that was just, I mean, I think it could be laid out a multitude of ways. That was just kind of showing the number of spaces that you could put in there. So, you know, when the city actually started the project, if there was a different way that they wanted to lay out the parking, I mean, I think it could be done several different ways as far as entrances and exits. But remember, there's also a side alley too, not the main alley, but a side alley there. That, I mean, I don't.
That could be incorporated to that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think the way that the alleys run and the amount of space could be open, I don't think you'll have any issues with entrance and exit.
Okay.
So, but you can get out of the parking to that back alley or not?
I'm not sure. We're not showing that on here.
Yeah, you see? See, this is where.
Oh, wait a minute, we are, yeah. Sorry, out there, yeah.
I mean, it's got lines across it, but I got to believe you could.
You can, yeah, that's right.
So.
Like you said, he's just doing that for a visual effect.
That's not the final plan.
Right, when the engineer, like, when the engineer proposed those plans, that was, I mean, that was just for a reference to show, you know, to put the parking in the scale, but I mean, that could be done.
Yeah, parking could be done different ways since inside that space.
But, so the people that park here.
So it could be done cheaper.
Where are they going to be, where are they going? I mean, how are they getting, are they?
Getting in and out.
Are they trying to get to over Love Avenue? Is that what, I mean, where are they going? I guess, what's their purpose for parking?
Well, hopefully Commerce Way and Main Street, both.
It's really just another parking spot. I don't think it's.
How are they, I'm trying to think in reference of where that is in relation to where are they going to walk and then get to Main Street? Because there's nothing in between these buildings, right? You don't have to go to one end or the other to then.
You probably have to walk up to the alley, what I'm going to call in the back, that adjoins the Tiff Theater and walk down and up and around. Unless, now there was talk at one time about trying to find a place. This was just talk. This was just an idea. This isn't set yet. Trying to find a place somewhere along one of those buildings along Main Street or around the theater, possibly at the Colonial Inn, where there could just be a walkway through. So you wouldn't have to go down around the block.
There was talk on that.
And that's what you want, is to spend a lot of money on a parking lot that nobody parked in. I mean, just because I'm not going to park there because I'm not going to walk all the way down and around and, you know.
But the hope too.
You haven't solved the problem.
Right, but the hope too, I think, with this was with the redevelopment taking place on Commerce Way, with the addition of restaurants and a market and some different things that are being proposed and talked about, this would provide parking for that. And I know we've got the parking lot across the street that's just been redone. That adjoins the old BB&T Bank building there. That's public city parking.
So let's build a parking lot and they will come.
Yes.
Everyone complains about needing more parking downtown, so.
I mean, I realize, let's make sure that the parking is where people are going to use it. I agree with the needing more parking, but they got to be able to use it to, you know.
And we've committed to be partners with the Downtown Development Authority in this, and the numbers that will be, that Pete's proposing. There was the original project that was submitted that was just removing both buildings and that was that. The parking lot would go in, and this is the city's portion, this is the grant portion, and this is what DDA, the Downtown Development Authority, will contribute. So we had that pot of money. Well, then the thought was, but what if we tried to save the facade, not of the Davis Music Building, but the building next door, because it has some unique architectural features. And could that be aesthetically pleasing and enhance the area, you know, and preserve that facade? But to do so is going to be about $63,000 more. So the question is, where does that come from and to contribute into that pot of money to complete the project?
Well, I would say, you know, since really the DDA has suggested this, that the DDA look at funding that.
And that's where we need to get these numbers that you'll get to.
Just, I want to make sure you knew that. I think Lucretia's been instructed also to reapply for some additional funds for the grant itself that may cover some of that. But I want to make sure that I provided you accurate numbers. And if that's the desire, then I'll certainly get this out to the DDA board.
You know, personally, I'd like to see the facade preserved. I think it's very attractive. I think it would be an enhanced area. I think it would be something kind of unique And it's just a detail that I think it's a nice detail, but it's, you know, it's costly. And
yeah.
So we've just got to figure out how to cover that cost.
Well, I believe Lucretia looked into it, and I think there's not really any money available for the facade per se, but I think that the community development said that we could use, we could reallocate some of the money
mm-hmm.
that's in the project if there
right.
was money left over.
Right,
to help
cover that. Okay.
But just bring up a good point, and we have to work towards design, how it's going to flow. The alley
sure.
in the back is one way anyway, so really has to be some careful consideration given as to how this is going to work.
Yeah, well, none of that's really been done yet as far as where the parking spaces are. And
these are just conceptual plans
exactly.
at this point, so nothing concrete. Okay. All right, Jared, anything else you need to add from the DDA standpoint? You're right. Just okay. When's y'all's next meeting?
Should be next week, I think. Right?
Next Tuesday.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Any other questions or comments on the Commerce Way parking lot project? Right here.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Now we are under our new business section of the agenda. And we need a resolution, or to discuss a resolution to amend the city's purchasing policy. Do you want to go over that?
Yes, I will. Thank you. Rob and I have talked with changes that we're doing with projects. Our purchasing policy, as it currently sits, doesn't give a lot of flexibility, especially anything over $25,000. It says now anything under that amount I could approve, but from $25,000. Over $100,000, we have to do a formal bid process. And Rob and I have talked, and he has helped draft something where it's tiered. And I'm just offering this as a recommendation to help us, especially with Jeff and ESG, as we do these small projects, that that the tier, anything $24,999 below, I could still handle. But as we go up $25,000 to $49,000, $999 required three written quotes and my approval, and then $50,000 to $99,000 requires three written quotes, and that you'd have to approve that. And then obviously the law says anything over $100,000, we have to formally bid that out. And I'm just asking for a little leverage here, because we're seeing just a lot of these little projects that are road or public works oriented, that we're getting quotes and we're doing right, especially with the local preference and local contractors, that if we could ease this up on the public works side, because there's nothing that says anything about that, it would really, really help facilitate some of the work that we're trying to do. So just
let me just add to what Pete just said. You know, looking at the statute for the public works construction contract is, it does not include municipal roads. And when you look at the public works construction definition, it refers you to the municipal road section in Title 32. And so when you see the new section 22 that's referenced in here, it basically says that we will follow the state law when it comes to road improvements. And basically, you know, road improvements is construction, reconstruction, repair. What's interesting about the state law is that, you know, by statute, it basically says that any contract for work on all or part of the municipal road system shall be in writing and approved by resolution, but shall be entered on in minutes of such municipality. So really, when you start talking about road work, it basically requires a resolution according to the state statute. When the limitations on roads is basically, if it's anything $200,000 or more, that requires a bid. Anything between $20,000 and $200,000, the state law requires two estimates. So that's kind of the difference that you're dealing with between a public works construction contract and a road contract. Also, the state law requires that anything over $5,000, you have to have both a performance bond and a payment bond. So actually, when you look at the state law requirements for roads, municipal roads, and repairing municipal roads, it's pretty stringent. So when you're looking at that section, new section 22, that's basically just saying we're going to follow state law, but again, it's very stringent. And if we're going to do any improvements on our municipal roadway system, that's going to have to come before council for resolution.
Anybody have any concerns, questions, thoughts? You good? Okay.
Yeah.
Good till next, till Monday.
Till Monday, okay.
Before we get ready to vote on it, they'll have 15 questions.
Of course.
But if I have any question before, then I'll.
Actually, this came up last week, you know, Jeff West and I met, and we still can get into these smaller projects as Pete was talking about, and going through a formal bid process, you know, is, you know, time consuming. And if you're getting, you know, some good estimates from three individuals, and you look at these numbers, if it's something smaller than Pete can approve, something's larger between 50 and 100, then get the estimates, then you all approve.
Sure.
So I think it's a, it makes it a little bit easier for these guys to get the quotes and get the work done.
Okay. All right. All right, if you do have questions, just direct those to the appropriate parties, and then we'll be ready to decide that at our next meeting. All right, the next item on our agenda is the Chestnut Avenue parking project. Pete,
okay.
You want to go to that?
Yes, I will. Thank you. We have received the title opinion from Buck Rigdon. We've been talking about this project for quite some time, too. Seeing and talking to him and talking to the DDA, we're finally clear on title. DDA has worked that out, so along the right-of-way and along the Chestnut Avenue, we is now our property.
Okay.
So we were a little concerned with that, just to kind of update you. If you remember, we wanted to widen Chestnut right there because of the new residential and with the restaurant, widen that road, put in some parallel and some diagonal parking, put in some lighting, maybe some landscape, just an overall improvement that can continue on to Brumley Way. So I think it's a really good project. The DDA knows about this. They fully support that. There is a map in your book that shows where we'll be going. Adding 14 and 22 parking spaces along this route, which I think would be obviously very, very welcomed. And then most importantly is the overall improvement to the whole area, what Mr. Harper did with the residential and the restaurant facet. So I think it'd bring a lot to this section. I'm estimating it, and I'm a rough estimate, somewhere probably pretty close to $300,000 to do this. There is an MOU that we did talk about it, and this would be a 50-50 split with the DDA. So I'm prepared if you are. Again, I could send this also to the DDA so they understand where we are. I'm going to have to select an engineer to do the formal plans, give us some renderings, and then get this. This will be a public works project that will be out to bid. So give you an example of where we would have to do that. And be some paving, be some lighting, some aesthetics.
Okay. All right, any comments, questions?
Yeah, this is a project the DDA has been working on for quite a while.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope to kind of make it look so it kind of flows into Brumby Way. It all looks the same pretty much.
Exactly.
Improves that area.
Exactly. That would be nice. Any other comments, questions? Okay. All right, very good. The next item on our agenda is the contract for the amendment to the contract.
Yeah, Jeff will come up too if there's any questions too. If you remember, this is just an amendment. We've taken the budget numbers, which you approved last month, and the only thing that we did is deducted $85,000 in the public works budget to put this particular position back in as a city employee. So the only thing that this amendment does is reflect the minus the $85,000, everything else is the same, and it's based off of this year's budget, so nothing else changes.
Okay.
And Jeff can answer any questions if you like, but we need to do this to make sure our numbers are correct.
Sure.
For what ESG
sure,
is.
Sure, in line. Okay, any questions, comments about this? Okay, I think it's pretty simple. So you got a visa, Jeff. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Jack will think of something, though, I'm sure.
I'm not liking the way those clouds are looking.
Oh, no, look at that.
We're not under a tornado, are we?
Well, we keep getting severe thunderstorm warnings. We can all go down to the basement. All right. The next item on the agenda is to discuss Golden Environmental rate increase for solid waste collection, service concerns, and contract specifics. So, Pete, we'll start with
okay,
that discussion.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. If you remember, just two meetings ago, we brought this forward, shared June 1st, 2018. Richard did send us a letter about a price increase.
Since that time, there was a solid waste committee meeting, so we've done a lot. So before you tonight, and obviously for discussion, you would consider the price increase, which obviously would be passed along to the residents. And just to give you an idea, currently, the solid waste fee is $15.13. Richard has requested $16 a home. That's an 87-cent increase. Give you an idea just what that equates to. We have about 4,800 utility customers, so it's about a $4,000 a month increase overall. Again, I didn't calculate percentages, and I could do that if you wish, but this, we have to obviously discuss this, and you make it determined based off of the options and where we are. But I think along with that, there's opportunity to talk about the service complaints and where we are with resolve with regards to certain things that we've talked about again some years ago. So the Solid Waste Committee met. They've talked about it three times. You directed us 2 months ago to come back and kind of review where we are from the complaint status, from the contract, and obviously wanted to share that with you. Rob is prepared to do that. So for you, it's addressing the rate increase or addressing the service/contract, or we do it together. But we have to discuss this together and obviously come up with some kind of decision or resolution how you like to proceed. So.
Okay. And I know Richard's here. Richard, I appreciate you being here this evening. So if there's any questions or anything, do y'all want to invite Richard to join us at the table, or do you want to discuss it amongst ourselves, or you want to hear Rob's presentation? Rob, why don't you go ahead and share with us what you have?
Yeah, basically, as I recall, I can't remember what meeting it was, but I was directed to take a look at where we stood with service complaints, where we were with the contract, and what we have attempted to do is go through basically the history of the service and where the complaints are coming from and what they basically consist of. And so we've done that. We've gone back to 2016 where things started, and I have not made copies, but as you can, this is basically what we have for emails regarding customer complaints, and they're a variety, but the majority of the complaints really arise from the leaking garbage trucks, I think is a major issue, the lack of pickup of yard debris, and sometimes missed service. And these things have been going on for quite some time. I think there's still issues with even getting DOT numbers on the trucks. So, I've reviewed everything. It appears these issues have been addressed with Richard. I know there was a letter back in July, I believe, of 2016, perhaps, after Mr. Ryan and myself met with Richard to address them. Again, we another letter from Pete addressing the same issues on October the 3rd, 2017. There's another letter of August 14th of 2017 addressing these issues. And I can say from my review of the complaints that subsequent to these notifications of these issues have still continued and we're still receiving complaints. We've also got numerous complaints that our customer service department has had to handle, and they go back to 2015, 2016, and they're numerous. And it appears one of the problems that we're having is our customer service department is having to deal, taking these complaints, and then of course Mr. Hobby dealing with these as well, and I know City Council has had to deal with them as well. So. I know that the initial question here is when we're talking about a rate increase, and I think that a rate increase, we'll discuss that perhaps, is it warranted from the services that you're getting and the complaints that you're fielding. And I can certainly provide any member of council, I can scan all these emails, there's photographs, there's videos, people sent to us, and I think a lot of it is really centered around these leaking trucks and poor quality.
Richard, can you grab one of these chairs and come slide up to this? Can you come talk to? Are you? You may not be prepared to talk tonight. I don't know, but it, can you address any of that? I mean, can you talk to us about any of that?
Absolutely. Well, I mean, where do we want to start?
Well, do you have leaking trucks?
We've had some. We sure do.
Today, do you have any leaking trucks?
Well, when it rains as much as we had, we do have some leaking trucks.
I mean, that's what I yes. get. I get the leaking trucks, especially in that Cambridge Court, Angeley Avenue. You talk to those people, and when they saw rate increase, they went ballistic. Because in their view, and this isn't one, this is probably six, seven, eight of them, know that the only way they're going to get things picked up is if they contact one of the neighbors who contacts me.
Yeah.
And they consistently talk about the leaking trucks and how they're tearing the road up and that kind of thing. And this goes on, this was 2 weeks ago when they said that they can't get yard debris picked up.
A lot of complaints.
And you and I have talked, it's not on a regular schedule, so they don't know when it's coming or when it's not coming. They'll say it's been 3 weeks. I'll be the first one to tell you, it might not have been 3 weeks. In their view, it's been 3 weeks. It might only been 2 weeks. You know, it might have been a week and a half. Some of them will go 4 weeks, and I know that to be fact. So that's, we're just not seeing an improvement, Richard.
The yard trash or waste is a very tough item, okay? It's not like we got 500 cans on a route. We know we're going to pick up 500 cans. Okay. We go out here, we might have 400 of piles as big as this.
Right.
But then we might have 100 as big as four or five cars. Mm-hmm. So we can't really move in that same direction as consistently, without having a barrage of trucks. So you go 2 days like this, Jack, where you live, it takes a truck 3 days to start at one part, come all the way around and finish around your side, and we've only done half of that one Monday route.
And they do a good job on that route.
Okay, that's 3 days, and that's only half. So it takes 5 days there. Put another truck, you're cutting it down to 2.5. A monumental task. It can be done, no doubt. Okay, we've had, and with all this rain, a barrage of grass clippings that fluctuates, the storms we've had, and little micro storms that'll show up. And you know, that's hard to manage.
But somewhere you knew what the scope was. We ain't added 200 houses since the video came about. And so somewhere you've got to be able to flex this thing so that those times that you do need two trucks instead of one running around, because you can't do it in the 5 days versus 2.5.
Mm-hmm.
The answer can't be, well, you know, it's taking 5 days. If I have two trucks, I can do it in 2.5. Well, chances are to get the job done, you're going to have the two trucks to get it 2.5 days on those things. So it's up to you to flex that thing to provide the service when these things happen.
I don't think their complaint is just the standard, the garbage is in my green can, and I know they're going to come on Wednesday and empty my green can. The complaints that I get the most about are recycling also going into the garbage truck. We've talked about this. Mm-hmm. Recycling going into the garbage truck. And I know you've got some trucks that are split.
We do.
So garbage is on one side, recycling is another.
That's correct.
And they can't necessarily tell what's what. But the recycling, and then it's the yard debris and what we call the bad loads, where you know, someone's moved out and they put a couch and a recliner out on the curb, and then all of a sudden it's not a couch and recliner. All of a sudden it's 15 additional pieces of furniture that came from somewhere, you know, and how's that going to get picked up? That's where we're getting a lot of complaints. And it seems to be, I know in Councilman Terrell's neighborhood, there's an awful lot of investment property and rental property, and I know that there's a turnover with that. So when that landlord goes and puts stuff out on the curb or in the alley and it doesn't get picked up, it just grows somehow or another. And so that's we have an awful lot of complaints about those kind of things. It's not the day-to-day garbage pickup, I don't think. I don't get any complaints about that.
Well, I do sometimes.
Do you? Okay.
Because of garbage being spilled on the ground.
Okay,
yeah. Pick up that type of thing. I do get those complaints.
So,
But as Julie said, this is not a new issue either. I mean, a lot of these things we've talked about, it's not just the weather. We've been hearing these complaints now for a year or two or 2 years. As with the vacant houses, I understand that, with the buildup and all that, but under your contract, you're supposed to let us know when your people come across those things and give us a report on those that can be addressed. And my understanding is you've never given us a report on that.
Not a report as a formal situation. We've made notes of
calls
of houses that were abandoned or foreclosed on and situations like that. Not a formal monthly report that 1002 Donaldson Street or 8th Street is vacant. But, you know, we'd have to follow up, which to call City Hall and say, is there service here? What's going on?
But I think you're supposed to give us a list. We're not a list of these things that we can be addressed. My understanding is we've not gotten a list from you, ever.
No, I've never provided that.
Okay, I know in your letter it said, you know, you want to work with the city and provide the level of service that we desire. And there's, you know, it's, and I don't know what the answer is, but when the, right now I can tell you that the level of service is not the level that we are comfortable with. And so, how we address that and how we fix that, I think, just like you, we're open for discussion so that because ultimately it's not us that have to determine that, it's the consumer, it's
right.
The citizens. And we do get an awful lot of complaints, and like I said, many times I'll just call you, you know, I'll just go straight to you and call, and so you're aware of those. And I know that Pete's reached out, and prior to that, Larry had reached out. So I guess I'm just looking for something from you to help us understand, as the body that's got to make the decision on this, how we can fix this. If we've had several discussions, if we've had several letters sent, what can we do so that level of service is what the citizens expect, and you're able to run your business as you need to run it as the private business owner, but we're able to feel comfortable about the decisions that we're making,
right,
and passing that on to the consumer so that they're getting the level of service that they need and expect. So
well, I mean, I think the discussion would be great, which, mm-hmm, you know, just take the landlord situation of the tenants. That's come around,
mm-hmm,
you know, for a time period there. We'd have to say, well, there's no service on the house.
Mm-hmm.
How do we pick it up?
Well, and this
so
is my
that,
question, too. If how that, do you know there's no service?
You call the city.
Oh, you call up here.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
And there'd be no service.
Yeah.
And that would majority point to landlord,
mm-hmm,
okay? And just like we said, that would grow, the pile would grow, and it would be beyond bulky items,
mm-hmm,
which clothes, dishes, you know, they didn't have service, they wouldn't have a trash can, or somebody stolen it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I don't know where to, you know, to operate there. I did charge initially 45 homes, which I knew was going to be an issue that would be in no man's land, foreclosures, for sale, for rent, abandoned. But I was grossly wrong about that many in the city of Tifton. It's more like 250 every month. So I was grossly wrong there when we initiated that. So I think we need to look at that. If that's where the city wants to operate at, we'd be glad to pick them up.
Tell me what's your process. If the truck's going down the road and there's couch and furniture,
that's right.
Is that what triggers somebody to call?
No.
What
triggers a call to check to see if that's an active customer?
Right.
If the house appears to be vacant or abandoned.
So if it appears to be
that's
vacant,
right,
then you will call. Who actually makes that call?
I do, or Barbara does in the office.
So somebody on the truck is calling.
Well, they're calling back to the office. Yes.
Okay.
Right.
So you're calling City Hall to find out, is this vacant?
Absolutely.
Somebody at City Hall knows, so can we somewhere, not trying to necessarily solve the problem here, but if we got Golden and we got City Hall and they both agree, this is a vacant house.
With no utilities, no garbage pickup being paid.
Okay, a list can quickly be made, whether whether Richard makes a list or whether whoever he's talking to at City Hall who has just told him.
Got locked.
There's no, you know, they can make the list. We now know that Richard called and said, this house looks vacant, and then we tell him, has no, there's our list.
So, you know, for example, being in real estate, I mean, I represent houses that are vacant, but they still have services. They're still paying for garbage pickup and getting the yard cut and all those things. So they look vacant, but they're still paying for that debris to be picked up, yard debris and everything, as if.
But not all are like that.
No, I know.
Not all are like that. Yeah, there's a good number. I agree. There's a good number.
You got to call, but we know on this end. We now know who he's calling about.
Right. Well, but like today, we got a video of a fella that videoed the and he was really put out about it because he I think had complained a couple of times of the garbage. Garbage truck pulls up, there's the garbage can and the recycle bin, and it's not the split truck, you can see the angle, it's just, and they just jump out, and in go both, and off they go, so.
Well, today we did not run the split body truck, we've got an issue there.
But if that's, you know, people are recycling, expecting that recycling to not go into the landfill, that they're going to the effort to recycle, which is what we encourage. Then how do we address that recycling going into the garbage truck, which then goes to the landfill? And we've got a lot of complaints about that,
yes.
Accusations. And I've just said, well, there are split trucks. Sometimes you can't tell and kind of brushed it off. But that's a video. I mean, it's
and that has happened in the last week.
Yeah.
And the last, go back 2 weeks prior to that.
So
we've had some trouble with
pick
that.
Up, just don't dump the recycled material. I mean, I realize that some of them might be full, but.
Well, that's, you know.
I'm a
double-edged sword.
I know.
Double-edged sword.
I'd rather not dump it.
You know, a double-edged sword there.
Yeah.
I think we should recycle. I'm a big.
Oh, I agree with. I mean,
go to the trouble to recycle.
Oh, absolutely.
That is
our commitment to do that. And I can count prior to 2 weeks ago, we missed very seldom. On recycling that was not completed.
You know, Richard, I think it was in October we sent you a 2-page letter detailing all the things we had done and all the complaints we've had. And it's my understanding, talking to staff, that we have not gotten, you have not addressed all those items on there, actually just very few of those items. And it seems to me that the time for talk is getting past here.
What happens, let me ask you another question, if we don't approve the rate increase, how does that impact?
Well, I'll give you what's happened on the recycling. When we did this, we were paid $10 a ton for recycling delivered to a material recycling facility. Now we're paying $35 a ton delivered. We're paying that, so a $45 swing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now we have to go to Tallahassee. And that's a long ways to get it processed. Facilities that are close at hand have all gone out of business and just not there anymore. So that has increased the cost for the recycling side of it. There has been an increase in the yard waste. Don't know what it's attributed to, mild winters, hot summers, wet, whatever it is.
Right.
So there's been an increase there. And I've also seen a dramatic increase in salaries to retain employees with our economy growing, okay? Probably to the tune of 15% to 20%. That's what I'm having to keep pace.
How many employees have you got? I'm just curious.
45.
How many?
45.
45, okay.
So
45 full-time.
That's city, county.
Oh, yeah, that's city.
Yeah, that's covering
everything. Oh, yeah. City, county, convenience site,
right.
Recycling.
Right.
Oh, yeah. So that, has impacted dramatically. You know, I also give a dollar reduction in the price to the city for the city collecting that money. That I really need that dollar back. You know, to keep up, really. I mean, it's changing dramatically.
Well, I don't see how we can really consider a price increase with the level of service that we're hearing from our customers.
I got you.
Let me ask you this, Richard. This is a picture from today after your collection. There's a lot of stuff, the guys that run the truck, when they empty the can, trash blow out, and they, a friend of mine called and said, he asked them about that, and they said that they weren't supposed to clean it up. But now, if you dump a can and trash fall out on the ground, then you should, the driver or the employee one should be responsible for getting the trash up. You see, you see that?
Oh, I see it.
I know
where it is.
That happened today after your pickup. Mm-hmm. So now, we need to address that. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it happened over time, but it happened in my district a lot. Mm-hmm. They dump the can, stuff trash fall out on the ground, they just drive off and leave it. That's the picture of that, what happened today.
Right.
So now, I can't ask my people for an increase with that kind of service. I mean, I just can't. 90% of the people in my district live in rental houses.
Right.
So now, if I need to go see the property owner or whoever I need to see, but I can't ask those people who barely paying the water bill to give you $1 or $2 more increase on a garbage service that we're not getting the service for. I mean, I'm not comfortable doing that, and I hope this don't come out the wrong way, Council, but I ain't no way in the hell I'm gonna vote for an increase in that. Just ain't gonna do that.
I just want to make a point that our contract allows for a 2% rate increase, and I think going to 16 is 5.75% increase. Is that correct?
Is that right?
That would be very close.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we need to keep that in mind. If we would.
I know, Council. We could probably talk about this. Frank and Johnny have done a great job with the committee, and we really have bottomed out this. It's just a kind of a merry-go-round. We've been around and around and around and talking about it. But mm-hmm. I think, nevertheless, I mean, in fairness, you know, Richard and Solid Waste, I mean, the collection is not easy today. I want to learn more. I didn't know about the recycling, so we're paying for to eliminate tonnages. I have to know about that. I wasn't clear on that. But I think if you allow for next meeting is if you want the Solid Waste Committee to meet one more time, Rob and I could put together, you know, probably the best, you know, one or two options that you have to take right now, and where we are, and then what you expect, and then we can communicate that.
I think that would be a good idea. What I'd like for you to do is if you and Richard could sit down and any, like the recycling cost increase, any challenges, you know, anything that you can provide to Pete so that he can have that information, because it really needs to be a dialogue.
I live here.
I know
is the back of my hand. And that there are some challenges. There's no doubt. All across the board. One thing, I don't enforce the guidelines for yard waste, okay, at all. I do not enforce it, okay? Now, if I enforce that, you would be barraged with phone calls. You'd say, what happened?
And there is that other side to it.
I brought
that up.
I do not enforce that.
And,
okay.
And reality, you should, or you
okay.
Work
well,
to
I'll be glad to
negotiate the contract. Fair is fair.
Okay.
Contract calls for this, and you're not enforcing it. Well, we're holding your hand. You know, we're pushing you on this other side to do it. So there's two sides, but the two of y'all got to get together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Johnny's problem with the loser. I took care of that at my house. I do not put any loose paper in the trash can. You know why? I know where it's going to go. Mm-hmm. It will go on the street.
And you
can do something about that. And there, I mean, it's these things right here, I guess, that are just evident to everybody that you could solve today.
Mm-hmm. Well, we also need to educate the public. I think that's part of the issue, too, because a lot of them don't know what to put out, what they can't put out. And that's on you to educate them to send out that information.
And
how is that mine?
Well, we
according to the contract, that's your last responsibility to do that.
But we have tried to, we've put out stuff on our website and Facebook page and flyers and different things. We as the city have tried to make sure that people know what you're responsible for.
I'm just a contractor. I don't have the authority.
But they don't know the details.
They mix furniture and yard waste. I said they're not gonna pick it up.
Or construction, they see a piece of wood with a nail and they throw it in there and they think that's yard debris and that's not.
The only thing I've seen from you is when we first started the recycling back and you had that, I think that card on top of the recycling telling them what can go in there, what can't go in there. But you need more than that for people to understand what they can put out, what they can't put out.
But if the two of y'all will get together and have an initial discussion just to kind of fine-tune what the list is of the concerns and both the concerns of the city to, you know, back to you as the contractor and then the concerns of the contractor back to the city, and then I think it would be beneficial to have the Solid Waste Committee meet one more time to review what the options are.
Yeah. Well, can we also have, you know, you talked about that recycling. That was good, the paperwork. Right? We need to put something out and attach it to all these yards. About yard debris.
Right.
Now, what some of these people are saying, what will fall on you is the pile might be too big. Well, it might be too big because you didn't pick up. So that's what I've told some of them. I said, your pile's good. They said, wait a minute, he hadn't been here to pick it up. And I realize you probably take some of that, but put something together and will you have them put it on the trash cans that give the customer, here's what you can and can't do with yard debris. And maybe they'll look at that the way they look at it with the...
Here's
what needs to be defined is what level of service do we want?
Right.
And
that's
if when they meet, they need to know that. Mm-hmm. Because if we're asking for a high level of service, well, he needs to know that, so he knows that, so they can...
Well, at this point, the level of service is what the contract says.
Yeah,
these issues that he's doing that are outside the contract to... you know, that he shouldn't do, you know, that's that higher level.
But
he's got to get the base level that we're
going
to right now.
But educating the consumer is part of the discussion. We can come up with a way to educate the consumer. So let's leave that with the two of them to discuss, because we have access through utility bills and, again, through all of our social media and websites and different things, and people just need reminders.
Something we can do jointly with
absolutely.
Do we need to, you know, you call about vacant houses, should you call the hall and get the message to Pete, you know, this house has this big pile that's outside.
It's falling ring off the door, off the hinges.
Well, but to be fair to Richard, we're blaming him, and I had somebody stop me in the darn at the gas station the other day. Well, I had seen the pile. It was almost to the nurse. I said, he's not going to pick that up.
Well,
you can't do that without.
There was a recent issue that Richard and I talked about where we were getting complaints in the 8th Street area. Come to find out the gentleman, the property owner, did not have service.
That house has never had service since we've been here.
Right. So, and talking to that, and I called the property owner. Well, he was livid because he didn't think he should have to pay for anything. So, you know, so then it's like, we'll let code handle that. Well, somehow or another it got cleaned up. I don't know if you picked it up or code visit.
No.
Okay, somebody cleaned it up, but it was probably a code visit.
Does he have service now?
No.
We went from a $23 a month trash bill, from my understanding, to a $15 trash bill. You know, 13.
I don't have a problem with the price increase.
It was $21 or something like
that. That is not going to cure the problem.
Right, that's right.
That is not going to cure the problem.
That's right.
At all.
But communication is
exactly
through this.
And
actions.
Addressing the supporting me out there by, if you have code ride by and you see this stuff out there it's not in a can, it's a pile of clothes, dishes and that. You know, am I the one to go to them and say, XYZ, I can't pick this up? They look at me like I'm some.
And I think that's where it begins.
Well, I think it's supposed to just let us know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let us know that you see this issue, and so we know it's there, that we can decide how to address it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
The phone rings off the hook for these piles that aren't picked up, that are wrong, it's to cover yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you have enough issues, and don't get me wrong, I give you a list of things that you're not doing right. But there's some things that you're getting blamed for that you shouldn't be blamed for. And you need to let us know what those are.
All right, let's go ahead and bring this to a head. We can, like you said, we can talk about the phone lines.
There's a lot to talk about, I'll be honest, but we have some core issues, and I'd be glad to have this conversation with Richard again. I'm talking about core business things that this supports, that we are, you know, we're talking about trucks, we're talking about personnel, we're talking about things that, we're talking about basics.
Yes.
So I could talk that through with Richard again, we certainly can. But when we talk about the committee, it needs to be all encompassing this. There's a lot of sides, but you're talking about root stuff that the city should be expecting via a collection contract. That's where the bottom line stuff.
Okay, John. Okay.
When you and I meet again, we'll be listen by code to come to.
Code enforcement.
Let's let Danny come.
Okay.
Since he's in charge of code enforcement. And then, we can get with Richard, and we can get, like I said, it's not all your fault, it's the trouble's property owners, especially in my district. They'll put somebody out and all this junk piled up. I know you're not gonna pick it up because it's a mixed load. They got furniture, they got paper, all this is in there. Let's get Cole in so he can get the property owner to, hey, now if you're gonna put this stuff out here on the curb, you need to call Richard and say, well, Richard, I'm finna evict this person today, and then I'm gonna put this furniture out there and let, so he, if he don't pick it up, then you pick it up.
But I think Wes is right. What level of service do we expect? And Pete knows what level of service we expect. So if the two of you can get together and then go from there. Let's have one final conversation and then
you and I are committed. Listen by Danny to come, so when we get issued, the code enforcement can help
us out. That's part of it.
And Ricky Hoppe knows it like back his hand too.
Yeah.
So it has to be wholesome.
Yes.
And I just don't want you to, you know, when I submit this to you, it's going to be very comprehensive, and I'm glad to have that conversation.
I just had one question. I didn't understand why the recyclables were being dumped into the garbage truck.
That split body truck we only have one of those, and it developed a problem where it would just run about a minute and just shut down, and we're still trying to figure that out. We can't figure it out. So
you run the garbage truck knowing that you're going to be dumping recyclables.
That's the two-edged sword, yes.
Okay. All right. Any other questions, comments? Please say no.
Suggest something else?
That's all again. Just, I was just curious.
Okay.
Well,
if y'all can get...
Don't recycle, is what I'm saying.
But if y'all
if can hold
get together in the next week...
Try and see.
Okay.
Blame me if it doesn't work. But I'd rather you not dump it. And it could be that it's not full. But my recycle, I don't feel it.
I do too.
And you know, that's
we don't use enough resources.
Okay.
All right. You want to set a time or just wait for your call?
I'll keep you call, and we'll work it around your schedule. How about
okay.
That?
Okay. Good deal. All right. Thank you, Richard.
Thanks. All right.
Okay. Next item on our agenda is a resolution for a new alcohol beverage license for Terminal South, located at 265 Brumby Way, and that is in our packet. Jessica, do you have anything to go over that with us?
Okay, this is a new bar that's going to the gin location. It would be right beside My Lady Bakery. Staff has done the investigation on the application and the applicants. There are three owners. It's a partnership.
In our packet. Any questions, comments about that? All right. City manager report.
Okay, just two things. I wanted to share with you the T-SPLOST paperwork. I didn't have those copies last time. Apologize, but pass it on, Jessica. This is the outline for. T-SPLOST, just in your reading, these are some frequently asked questions. If you want to
read through that. I'd be glad to talk about that. The 11x17 color copy, I wanted to give you a snapshot of what this looked like for us, and all the way down on the bottom you'll see Tift County. Okay, Tift County and then Tifton. The left hand is the 25% sales tax revenue distribution. This is monies that we were going to start collecting in November, $2.3 million. That is discretionary money that I'll be bringing to you for some decisions. We could do anything transportation related. We could
add a 10-year period, or that's every year?
Yeah, this will be 10-year period.
2.3 over 10 years.
That's right. So we could start adding that to the paving list. We could start doing sidewalks if you'd like to do, so we could keep our project listing moving along. But so if you go to the right, again, regional numbers, that's really not important, but if you look at the $12 million, that's what Tifton should see over the total benefit, 25%.
And our LMIG match went up, did it not?
It did.
Okay.
Yes. So that's just to give you, you know, when you say your discretionary money, this money will start collecting again. I don't know what the distribution is going to be. So if we could count on, you know, if we take this and divide it by 10, if we save it and we could add another, you know, four or five streets to our listing, this is what we could.
We got plenty of streets today.
Well, but it, you know, gives you some discretion if you want to do, you know, updating sidewalks to little bridges to things that anything transportation-wise, this is what the discretionary money for. So, and then the big sheet, this is a listing of everybody in our region. So if you turn to the back page.
Wait, this 8th Street widening the turn lane.
That's down there by Publix, though. That's way down there. That's at the.
How far down are we?
Almost
how far are we widening? How far off East Street are we widening?
Well, only where Virginia comes out, right there in front of Firehouse. So if you're in the right-hand lane and you try to get onto 8th Street, it's a convergence. It's an absolute disaster.
We're not going into people's yards.
No. It's just right there.
You're thinking, oh my God.
This is at the 75 entrance. So these are all the projects that you approved, and the dollar amounts. You could see what is allotted for each year. The only other thing I want to just point out, if you see up on top, band one. Let's see, take this back here. All right, on band one, you could see the cycle, 2018 to 2021. These are all the projects that we'll be doing. So band one is, again, you can see the years. Band two is 22 to 24, and band three is all the way up to 25 in 2028. So you could see some of the monies, like McCormick. That's way out there.
10-year
Secretary, long time for Secretary Page.
So
good things come to those who wait.
Great, you know, this give a little leverage for us tomorrow, a lot more leverage in the future, so with regard to transportation projects. So I want to share that with you.
Excellent.
And then lastly, I sent out word Friday, the Matt Wilson redevelopment meeting went well. I think we got a lot out. We're just trying to end some confusion with what this actually is, what we're supposed to be doing, et cetera. And I think one of the things that is clear, and the residents, obviously this is a resident-driven project, one of the things that very clear is are the properties, what they want to see in the future. And I wanted to bring this back around, and you could, you know, however you want to deal with this, I think we have really two legitimate ways to do it, and that is the mobile home parks. I talked to you about the zoning, about rezoning, having that designation part of our zoning. And really, there's only nine, if you remember the handout, there's really nine areas in the city of Tifton that are designated mobile home parks. You have the option to, you know, really look at changing the designation. And obviously, there's grandfathering in. We're not trying to do away with it, but it's just the zoning. So we're talking about future, we're talking about the comp plan, we're talking about Matt Wilson redevelopment. What is going to be in store for the future? And we have to move with that. It has to be fluid so we can keep up with that. That is one. But the other option you really have, and Rob could help us through this, is that until you understand, until the Matt Wilson tries to develop a little bit, we could actually do a moratorium on mobile home parks to just freeze that so
you have an idea to what we're up against, what it means for the city, how does this, you know, be rolled out part of our plans. And I think it really is big decision making for you as a city, or as the elected officials, to say that we're not opposed to this, but the zoning I really, really think needs to be updated this time, or we need to take a hard look at it. So we can't play, you know, we can't go to Matt Wilson and say, well, we see this, but if we don't have the correct zoning, you can't do that. And I think I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't point that out to you. So I think it's time to look at that, and I wanted to get your input on what y'all think and how you see that. Marion, when you were at the meeting, just where you think the residents and how that could turn into something positive with regard to our zoning.
I think, and Mr. Bertil is here, of course, Councilman Terrell was at the meeting too. I think that the meeting went very well. Bruce Green was here to sort of, and LaCresha facilitated the meeting. We had some very good discussion. I think the expectation of the neighborhood is they're looking to us to, you know, to I guess sort of be the catalyst for this really positive development. It was the main concerns, I think, were safety of the children. That was a priority, and Councilman Terrell certainly weigh in at any point in time. We had representatives there from the school PTO group and obviously from the school. They were very excited. And we were excited to see them there because that shows, you know, that it's an interaction. And then of course residents that live in the area. So it's a big project that's kind of hard to get your mind around. So it's kind of you gotta stop and think how you're gonna eat that elephant one bite at the time. But I think that the potential moratorium is one good step in the right direction, because we've got to get a hold on the expectation of how someone is to maintain and keep their property. If you live next door to me and you don't maintain your property and you let it deteriorate and run down, we have these garbage issues like we've talked about with Richard, and I'm trying to maintain mine, it pulls both of us down. And I like to use that phraseology, all boats rise and fall together. And it's pulling, when we have issues within a neighborhood, it pulls the whole community down, not just that neighborhood. And so I think that neighborhood is looking to us expectantly and positively to help implement some very positive change. But we want the, it's not me going in and saying, or you going in and saying, this is what is going to happen in this neighborhood. It's neighborhood driven, it's resident driven, and the people that own the property there. So, Mr. Patella, do you have anything you would like to add as a resident and as a member that was at the meeting the other day? What did you have any thoughts or anything you wanted to share with the council after that meeting?
Well, briefly, I would simply say that the need for development on the south side is obvious.
Yes.
I think that most people in the neighborhood see this as a glimmer of hope that something will happen.
Yes.
And the discussions that I participated in have been positive.
Good.
And I think that we can get something done here.
I do too.
As you know, I think that things should be done in a particular way. And that way is simply that we have real community representation.
Absolutely.
Because if we start out with community representation, we'll end up with a lot less problems at the end of whatever it is that we're trying to do.
Very true.
So we have to give the stakeholders, you know, a real sense of what's happening.
Absolutely.
But I think it's a good thing. I think it's a positive thing.
Yes.
And I think that we can get something done here.
And Bruce was very specific to say that, you know, we need to look at the potential of creating an authority that's comprised of property owners and neighbors and then, you know, potentially like a board of directors, sort of an advisory board. So we've got a lot of work to do. And one of the things we talked about at the meeting was that the wheels of government move very slowly, but there's a reason for that. And so we don't want to just go charging in full speed ahead without a good solid plan that has had lots of input and lots of consideration. And we talked about the community development block grant. Do we want to spend money underground or above ground? And so just had a very, very good meeting. So
I just want you all to be ahead of just the mobile home park designation. Again, we're not isolating this at all, but it's just how it fits into infill for residential, what the neighborhood, you know, could look like. And we're trying not to repeat. So I think it's very, very specific that giving you the information and just at least talking about it and how you see us moving forward with that.
Johnny, do you have anything you wanted to add?
No, I think we had a good meeting, and I think if like you said, the more people we get involved, you know, the better. My one concern, the first thing, that little trailer park right across from Matt Wilson School, as soon as we get a chance, we need to get some gas and throw that thing. And the fire department put it out. Because he ain't going to get no better.
I think that's a good, if you listen to what I'm saying, that's a good.
Yeah, I'm not this is kind of hand in hand in a different way.
Yeah, I ain't want to say it on fire, really. But I think, Chief Bennett, I was just joking.
That's cute back there.
Okay, I was just playing. But seriously, on a serious note, that little trailer park right across from Matt Wilson, that little thing there, if we could get that done, if we could just say, well, we're going to fix this. If we can get that done first, then the community can, everybody keep asking me, when are we going to do this? And I can't say, well, tomorrow or next week, because, you know, I don't know. But if we can just start right there and get that little thing cleaned out there,
right.
I think the community would just jump in and would just say, well, hey, they doing, we're ready to make a move on this. Because that thing has to,
yeah.
I mean,
well,
safety, because
yeah.
See, last year, a parent called me and said there was a man that was in there that exposed himself to the children passing through there. So I the policeman there, I called the police department, and Lieutenant Garfield and I went down there, and we found out where the house was that the guy was in. Okay. The police came in, so he moved. But the house, that old Baker trailer is still there. If we could take all that out, I think we have
an issue, not just in your area, but really around the city.
That's
yeah.
Exactly.
There's some places that have been grandfathered in.
We could talk,
yeah.
We could talk about if we don't fix the zoning so it can't,
yeah.
If we prevent it.
But,
from
but it's beyond, it's got to be more than that. We can zone, you can have trailer park zoned in an area, but if you let them deteriorate,
yeah.
It doesn't matter. Unless we put some teeth in it, what are the requirements? It has to
well,
be kept
I think that's what we've got to
yeah,
work
on.
And some of these are really far gone
yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really,
I mean, you can zone them into this area, and that zoning's fine.
Yeah.
In 5 years from now, these trailers are just, nobody's kept them up.
Right.
Unless we do something about that, we ain't done anything.
We have, of course, you have the International Property Maintenance Code, which is one tool. The other one, of course, is that, demolition of unsafe, unsanitary houses. We've done that, as
we enforce that throughout?
Well, we've taken down several houses.
Oh, yeah.
Naturally, the issue that you run into is you pay for the demolition and you may never get reimbursed, but in my mind, that's the cost of doing business.
Exactly.
Okay. Well,
how long are we going to do a moratorium?
That's something that we need to look at.
Okay.
You can't extend those out too long.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's just the parks now, the mobile home parks. It's
right.
Just, that's the only thing that
ideally, if you look at the three largest land areas around that Mount Wilson is the trailer park you're talking about, the one that's across the street, and then you have that housing authority that's right there.
And the housing authority was at the table and very willing to be productive.
Ideally, what I'd like us somehow or another to do is maybe figure out a way how we can swap land or do something to get that, so we can take over that area and then relocate those other people to another area, maybe provide them some land or whatever, somehow or another, that they build a new housing authority there. We take that and bulldoze that thing down and then build that into houses and neighborhoods as well. There's a lot of different options around that area, and
that's
if you add those three together, you're looking at about 20 or 30 acres for redevelopment.
Well, that's where having Bruce at the table, Bruce Green, is so important to me because, one, he understands the role of the council and the limitations that the city council has versus an authority, an urban redevelopment authority, versus a downtown development authority. So everyone has different roles, and the housing authority. And everybody's very willing to come to the table with the authority and the powers that they have based on whatever the state law is and whatever their role is, mm-hmm. and how we can make this a positive thing. So all of that's being discussed. So this is not something that, it's kind of like this T-Swap stuff. We probably won't see a lot of it for many, many years, but the point is the ball has started rolling. And so I think it was a very good, very productive meeting, and I appreciate everybody that was there willing to discuss.
It's just something
to discuss.
We need to stay ahead of.
Yeah. All right. Anything else on your report? Okay. We do need to go into executive session for legal matters, so unless there's